NDTV Realty Debate with Manisha Natarajan, powered by Reliance Home Finance.
Will and can Bangalore lead the real estate recovery in 2016, which the entire country is hoping for? That's the topic of our discussion today, and I'm here in Bangalore with an incredible panel. Just everybody who matters in Bangalore's real estate sector is with me. Let me start by introducing my panelists to you. With me, starting absolutely on the left, is JC Sharma, VC and MD of Sobha Limited. Mr. Irfan Razak, CMD Prestige Group and Chairman Credai. Also with us is Sushil Mantri, CMD Mantri Developers. Ravindra Pai, MD Century Real Estate. And Joe Verghese, MD Colliers International India. Let me just set the ground a little bit and just tell you what's been happening in Bangalore. Well, we were hoping that Bangalore would be able to withstand the slowdown. It has, better than every other place in the country, but 2015 wasn't a very bright one for also Bangalore's real estate, especially when it comes to residential. The reason why we are hopeful that Bangalore could lead the real estate recovery across the country is this simple data. When it comes to office space and commercial, Bangalore has led the pack. If you look at some of the figures, I'm just going to look at one number because too many numbers can be confusing. It accounted for 44% of leasing activity in the fourth quarter of 2015, followed by Delhi NCR. So NCR, even with Gurgaon, has fallen behind Pune, Chennai and Mumbai. So let's begin. Mr. Razak, first question to you. Is this something which gives you confidence that 2016 could be the year of turnaround, or do you think it's a little early?
No, I believe with the type of job creation that has happened, with office space leasing hasn't been better than in 2015. We've come to a state of no vacancy, which is a really good
scenario. It's a good problem to have.
A fantastic scenario to have. Because what's happened is, because the demand is still sustaining, the rents are slowly getting pushed up. At least now we are able to feel that we are about able to realize the true value of our properties. Otherwise, when it was a scenario where there was supply, more supply than demand, we had no choice but to drop our prices to see that our properties got filled up. Today, the scenario is, I'm not saying that we are getting top dollar rents, but what we are doing is it's at least coming to near investment value, the return on our value, and we seem to be smiling. All real developers who are in the office space are definitely very happy and have a big smile on their face.
On their face, okay.
And another flip side is, now the pressure is on the consultants who we are saying, listen, now you need to reduce your fees.
All right, Joe Verghese, that was completely directed at you. Okay, we'll come to the consultant piece a little bit later. Mr. Sharma, why then has this not, is there a time gap? I mean, historically, do you see that once office space leasing activity picks up, what is it? Is it a two-quarter cycle, four-quarter cycle, when your housing demand will also follow and show that big sign of revival?
I believe that definitely the office space absorption assures that the real estate residential space absorption will follow. It's a matter of a time. I don't think a quarter or two quarter a kind of a gap should be there, because the people who are being absorbed in such spaces, basically they are being recruited at the entry level and they may not be able to afford the home. But at the same time, there will be pressure on the rentals, there will be pressure on the people who are otherwise getting graduated to the next level sort of a thing to take the call as rentals start increasing. And in a regime where the interest rates are falling, people go for flexi rate of interest, and when they know that the absorption of the commercial space and the new jobs are getting created, the residential demand has to follow. In our case, 2015, we have done more than 20% in volume terms increase. And I believe that 2015, in case of Bangalore, as far as the normal offtake is concerned, it has been a better year than 2014.
Would you agree with that, Mr. Mantri? 2015 has been better than 2014, at least in volume terms. In value, I understand that everybody had to shift their focus from premium to, let's say, more modestly priced homes. That was a big turnaround in terms of the product which came in the market.
See, what happened, like, if you see last 2-3 years data, 2014, almost about 11 million square feet office space was leased. Then 2015, almost 14 million square feet is leased. And the current year estimate is around 14 million square feet. So that means so many jobs are getting created. Now, in IT, we normally take for every 100 square feet, one job. So now we, last year we got created 1.4 lakh jobs. Before that, 1.1 lakh jobs. And you take non-IT jobs that supported with this. Whenever somebody move to the Bangalore, because for the job they get, because a lot of Bangalore people are already having job, so many people get recruitment from outside.
There's a lot of influx.
Yeah,
new young population flux. Coming.
So now when this new population come, first 1 or 2 years they take for rental property, and then they move for the, because they, by that time, understand Bangalore and decide which property to buy. And one good thing about this city, whoever comes to Bangalore normally don't like to go back.
Ah.
They normally settle down here. So, you know, and today...
It's Hotel California. You can check in, but you can't check out of Bangalore. Is that it?
And now,
everybody's feeling so good about Bangalore.
No, and another thing I'll tell you. Today, with a single-digit interest rate, if you pay the rent or you pay the EMI, both are same. And when youngsters comes, anyway, everybody would like to buy a home. These people prefer to buy a home. Now, we developer reacted to this demand and made a compact size homes, because Bangalore is known for big size home. And now, if I am getting a new job
today... So, that's been a big trend of 2015. Will everyone agree that the whole product range has been, portfolio has been revamped to smaller, compact and more affordable homes? Ravinder, come in here. Is that how you see it?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the demand is really, and I'm sure my senior colleagues will agree, is more in the 50 to 80 lakh bracket. If you today see the inventory, I mean, you know, the well-publicized that, you know, the inventory in Bangalore, the overhang is, you know, second highest in the country. Of course, the numbers are suspect because we don't know whether it's only under construction units or only, are we talking about ready apartment units as well? You know, but really, and most part of the, you know, the inventory is, you know, 33% of the inventory, I'm told, is over a 1 crore budget, whereas demand clearly is in the 50 to 80 lakh. And many of them have responded. I think, you know, if you look at a Purvankara today as a Provident brand, I think Sobha has launched a, you know, a budget sort of a brand. Prestige is, you know, has come up with a one bedroom unit. So I think the developers are responding, but the realignment takes a little bit of time. You know, unfortunately, in real estate, from project planning to you know, sort of launch is a good 9 to 12 month period, and it takes time for developers to react to this new scenario.
Absolutely, it's not something that a product portfolio cannot be changed overnight. There is a time gap. All right, you spoke about the overhang figure, and you know, this is something which is constantly being debated about. When you look at numbers, what is this inventory overhang? So I've got numbers. Hosa Road, 59 months, which means current stock is going to take that long for it to be sold. You've got Yelahanka at 46 months, but these are looking like some of the most overhung markets or markets which are slowed down. After that, markets like Markahalli and Thani Sandra are 13 and 15, which we've always considered, Joe Verghese, as being very, very safe. I mean, you know, that's hardly any inventory really in terms of overhang. But would you agree that 2015 for Bangalore developers was also a wake-up call for some of some sorts, that they all were launching projects in that premium range, and they literally had to wake up and smell the coffee, which was a good thing to have happened?
Yeah, I actually think that happened everywhere. And
your fees won't go down, you can be honest.
Yes. I won't say anything that'll bring my fees down, but no. But that actually happened across the country. And in Bangalore, especially the Bangalore developers, have a knack to very quickly understand what the market pulse is. And almost everyone has come with products in that range. So a lot of the overhang you see is related to launches that have happened 2-3 years ago,
right,
and products that have not sold. Real estate is an extremely local business. So if you actually see the products that were launched in the last 18 months, a lot of absorption have taken place in those products versus the products that were launched about 36 months ago, right? So a lot of the overhang is a result of that. I think the developers have adapted and figured out what will sell in the market, and that's why you see this products in this price range starting to do well.
Do well. All right. Let me come to then something which is beginning to worry. Here we were looking at the commercial data figures and saying, look, Bangalore should lead the recovery, if at least on paper and on numbers, it is showing those signs. But Mr. Razak, you're also following the stock markets. You're looking at the global picture. Just when we thought we were out of the woods, here you have another big global issue looming, and China melting down, oil crashing to below $30 a barrel. So there are two ways of looking at it. One is that if the stock markets are so volatile, you will have buyers and investors coming back to hard asset like real estate. Second would be that, look, if the confidence in the economy is not there, people would not want to put upfront a large amount or make a large commitment like a home. Which way do you think the wind will blow?
No, like you rightly said, Manisha, stock market, if it's unpredictable, not many people will venture into it except for the FIIs and the big ticket investors. The smaller retail investors will definitely feel much safer to invest in a hard asset like real estate, because history has proved that over a period of time, if you've got spare cash, you're not into speculation, you're buying in a good location, in a good development, there's always growth in capital. It's never happened. I've not seen it. I've been in this game for more than 36 years. I've not seen the value of real estate diminish unless there's some litigation or there's some problem with the property. It's only gone upwards. There is a time where there's a stage where there is slow growth, and there's a stage where suddenly you have a high jump. So I've always advocated that, especially investing in real estate, A, it's an asset that you can see, which you can really hold, and it's something that you can own and pass it on to generations. The second thing is, real estate, unlike any other consumer good, whether it's a luxury car, it doesn't depreciate in value. I always tell my developer friends, listen, you're in the business of creation of wealth. You are doing this for generations, and you're not producing ice cream which will melt away. And in stock market, your wealth can melt away very fast. And that doesn't happen in real estate. You can't be a billionaire one day in the stock market, and you can be nobody in one day in the stock market. That never happens in real estate. So that's the inherent strength of real estate. And that, with the numbers, sheer population we have, sheer earning population that we have in our country, not only Bangalore, I believe that is a big, big plus sign for anybody and everybody who's got the wherewithal, the spare cash to invest. I do not advocate speculation. I do not advocate trying to pull out your business funds or spare cash which you had kept for something else, bringing it here, trying to take it out within a few months. It
so
may
speculate.
Work certain times, mm-hmm. but it doesn't work all the time.
All right. Mr. Mantri, Mr. Razak spoke about price appreciation. So everyone's curious to know what's been happening in Bangalore market. We've just got some representative markets to say what happened in 2015. A market like Hebbal just went up by 2.7%, but still there was nothing negative here. While a Panathur market even gave you returns of 13.7%, almost 14%. So the range within Bengaluru market of what you've earned in terms of price appreciation is also huge. So when somebody's looking at buying as an investment, because right now we are talking about stock markets versus real estate as an investment, not for an end user, how do you think he should pick the right markets in Bengaluru?
See, Hebbal, what example you have given, because they were the old designs and high-value product. And that is the reason the appreciation was low. But still, if you see the high-value comparison of any other metro city, you will find Bangalore has appreciated, not depreciated. Now, if somebody is looking for an investment, it may be a rental or price appreciation. I would recommend, let's go for more mid-market segment, where they can rent it out, because Bangalore gives about 4 to 5% return per annum on the rentals, and that can give a handsome return. Plus, this mid-market segment can appreciate much faster.
Is the sweet spot for investors and end buyers now pretty much, Mr. Sharma, it's 50 lakhs to 80 lakhs in an upcoming market where you can see a lot of commercial office activity should be the way to move with real estate investments?
I think, yes, definitely 50 lakhs plus is a sweet spot, because the youngsters, they are taking the call to buy the homes a bit early than when we used to sell in good numbers, only 3-bedroom or more set of an apartments. So you have created, in my view, a new category of buyers because of our ability to understand the pulse of the problems as well as the pulse of the would-be buyers, that they will take the call immediately and buy.
So what I feel that there has been a complementary product we have been able to offer in Bangalore now, which is being purchased by the new set of buyers. The buyers who used to buy the 3-bedroom, 1 crore plus kind of an apartment, they have become a bit tentative at this point of time, and they are taking their own call. But since the new inventory which we have released is basically of these compact homes, the Bangalore has seen the traction also. At the same time, Bangalore is also witnessing somewhere slowdown also. Clearly, both these things are happening. But net-net, the price appreciation will continue, in my view, in all the locations. These are basically a naturalization process. Sometimes in some particular area, when the prices go fast, we figure out where to go now. Rents are available cheap, we can price it better, and then the development takes care of the price appreciation.
So you're saying new areas which come up where the base is lower would probably have higher appreciation. That's something which will happen. Are you worried, Mr. Sharma, of 2016, when you look at the global headwinds? I mean, this is something which is worrying even media companies like us, which is saying what will happen to our advertising revenue if there is so much uncertainty in 2016?
See, when we look at the global economy today, the basic postulate is greed and fear. Today, American economy is doing exceedingly well, but it is also getting impacted by the Chinese so-called slowdown, where the so-called slowdown is not that kind of a hard landing. It's some 0.5% to 1% kind of a slowdown this economy is going to witness, where investment-driven like demand will contract and consumption-driven demand will take over. The transition is taking time. For India, it's the fear factor because the FIIs have been primarily withdrawing the money. But basically, it has been made up by the domestic institutions' money, which is the money being provided by the retail investors who do not understand. Our market has been the most steady market. Our rupee has been the most resilient currency in the world. And I believe 2016 will be the year of India, even whether it is stock market or even with it is real estate market. In whatever way you look at it, if we meet next year, 2017, we'll be seeing
We definitely want to play this as a big promo line.
Yeah.
All right, Ravi, you come in here. Any worries with what's happening globally? I mean, do you think that that could delay the recovery that one is hoping for in real estate in 2016?
From a sentiment perspective, I think yes. You know, I mean, people before making that decision, the macro environment, you know, the sentiment is very, very essential. But I would slightly disagree that, you know, I mean, people are really looking at real estate only as an investment. It is really a need. You know, I mean, people are buying a home to live. You know, so irrespective of, you know, what's happening in the stock market, you know, what's happening, and some of these things I think are really good. I mean, oil coming down, I think, is good for the country, you know, being net importers. So I think, you know, eventually there's a need, and people, while the sentiment may get affected, I don't really foresee that, you know, it's going to affect the market really in that sense, you know. And
okay.
Really, I think it's come down to affordability. If people can afford it, if they feel it's the right price, and I can talk for everybody here, I don't think prices can come down, you know, because the input costs are so high.
That's what everyone wants to constantly debate, whether prices are likely to come down even further.
So sentiments are affecting only from that perspective, where people are sitting on the edge really wondering whether to make the decision now or to postpone the decision. I think sooner than later, people are going to jump over the fence, are going to realize the price are not going to come down any further, and take the plunge, and especially with the interest rates also coming down. I think it's going to be a good year, if you ask me, for real estate especially.
Okay. So, Vagi, sum up for us the global headwinds versus what you see happening domestically. There are other concerns even which we have, right? GST in a logjam. If you look at corporate India's profit growths, they've been nil. Top line growth has been nil. Export growth has been zero in 2015. So there is a government which is trying very hard to move things, but they're taking their own time. What do you think will happen? How will all these factors play out?
Bangalore is actually very uniquely positioned compared to the other cities when you take all these circumstances into account. So if you look at even from 2000...
I forgot, you've got all the unicorns and the big tech companies who don't care about GST.
From that from that perspective, yes, but also from a perspective of the fact that Bangalore's cost competitive advantage continues to be a great USP when the global economy is down. If you see from 2008 and you look at the absorption, commercial absorption in Bangalore from 2008, when the whole global economy was down, actually the absorption in Bangalore was the highest compared to the rest of the country, and it continued to be the highest. It retained the number one position, because while you're trying to be cost competitive across the world, moving your back office to Bangalore or providing services from Bangalore becomes a great advantage, right? So the underlying economic activity continues to be very strong in Bangalore. So I foresee that Bangalore will continue to be a great market both for commercial and residential, right? The beauty about Bangalore is that.
So you're saying that it's more shockproof? Because it has its own advantages which will continue to keep it robust on the commercial office space front?
That has been what has been happening historically, and I don't see any reason why that should change.
All right. Okay. So we're going to take a very quick break here. Undeniably, if you look at the new trend which is emerging, which we captured in Pranoy Roy's interview with Richard Sharma, he said the world now is not about bricks, it's about FANG. And FANG is, of course, Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google. So, well, if you look at the FANG alike in India, all of them probably, or most of them, happen to be in this city, which is Bangalore. You've got amongst your unicorns, you've got a Flipkart here, you've got a Quikr here, you've got Amazon right in the World Trade Center where we're recording this from, in Mobi, and we hear that Paytm's moving too. So how will all of this play out? Yes, it seems that the panel here says Bangalore should be doing well in 2016. The other thing which everybody wants to know, what happens to Bangalore's carrying capacity? Lots of influx of people, but the road, the congestion, the livability factor of Bangalore, how will that change? And will anything be done to improve that in 2016? Stay with us.
The Realty Debate with Manisha Natarajan, powered by Reliance Home Finance.
Will Bangalore lead the real estate recovery in 2016 for India? Well, the city has been very resilient when it comes to real estate. You also have this as a big base for all IT, ITS, and now startups being located in Bangalore. The livability of Bangalore, though, people have started cribbing, complaining and saying, hey, look, we love working here, but it's not easy to live in Bangalore. Some of the big developments which were to happen, look at the record which the city has. Metro Phase 1 is still incomplete. That's a big one. The peripheral ring road, or PRR, is a project proposed in 2005. It's still on paper, not seen the daylights. Bengaluru's commuter rail, which was proposed, is not happening. So I've got everyone here with me to answer that big question. Let me start with you, Ravindra. Do you worry about the fact that, you know, in the last 10 years, now people say that the governance of Bangalore, or let's say Karnataka and Bangalore being the hub of it, or the big star in that portfolio, has actually been poorer than any other states like UP and Bihar. Seriously, that's what I'm hearing.
You know, I worry about it till I leave Bangalore. You know, when I'm in Bangalore, I complain. But the minute I go out of Bangalore and I come back, and then I realize how fortunate we are. Uh-huh. You know, when the airport door opens, the lovely weather that greets you, or, you know, let's say now the flyover that gets you to Hebbal in 20 minutes time. Well, I mean, there's a lot to be desired, don't get me wrong. And I'm not saying it is great. Traffic is an issue. But on most other indexes that you talk about, you know, and we chatted about this a little before this panel started, educational institutions, you know, I mean, we possibly have the best educational institutions in Bangalore. We have, you know, I mean, the climate, of course, is to die for. I mean, you know, it's envy of, I think, rest of the country, or maybe even many parts of the world. So, in, you know, from a livability perspective, I think other than the traffic, really, I think everything is, I mean, there are a lot of good things that are happening. I think the government also recognizes this. You know, it's not that it doesn't recognize it. Now they have a minister that is focused only for Bangalore development. You know, so we're hoping that there
Mr.
will be.
Mr. KJ George?
Yeah, so we're hoping that there is some amount of focus that comes to really, uplifting the infrastructure, you know, some of the things that you talked about. In fact, the PRR has been in the news last 3-4 days. I've been reading, you know, it's been in the media that, you know, the tenders are now out and they're expecting to complete it in 3 years' time. So I think the government also is cognizant, you know, that I think they have milked Bangalore dry to some extent. It has grown in spite or despite our politicians or our,
despite no governance.
Despite no governance or leadership, as we may say so. But I think, you know.
So you think the appointment of the city development minister, Mr. KJ George, Mr. Razak, is an indication that the government has woken up, realized that, look, if they don't do something, they may lose that competitive advantage to others like Chennai and Hyderabad?
I think that they've realized that they need to have a focused minister who will take care of the issues of Bangalore. Having said that, you see, Bangalore has grown exponentially. Nobody expected that growth. Nobody expected...
But Mr. Razak, we've been saying that for the last 3 years that I've been doing the property show.
Here always play the catch-up game. Like you rightly said, Manisha, now the metro is still to be a reality. Right now it's opened up only in parts, and I would say it's only like a toy train. The day it opens up fully, the entire 42 kilometers get done. That underground portion, because of the topography of the Bangalore and the tunneling and all that which they are struggling through, hopefully they are hopeful that they'll open it sometime, say March, or then they're saying another 3 months more for one more line. But I believe that by June, we'll have the entire 42 kilometers of metro networked. That will make a big difference the way we commute. And the realization that, look, the roads need sprucing up, some more infra work needs to be done. Though a lot has been happening, but it's not visible. And then because of, many reasons, somehow the other, there has been a little bit of neglect. I think now with the focused activity that we have, and we have a focused minister for Bangalore, Mr. George, I believe that suddenly there will be a change.
All right. Would you agree with that, Mr. Mantri, that the city's infrastructure, especially the transport and the movement infrastructure, needs a huge upgrade? That's going to turn out to be a big bottleneck for even developers sooner than later. If you don't have the roads, I mean, it's going to be hard to sell projects. If you have so much of traffic congestion, it is going to be a big challenge.
See, I will tell you, I think we need to study the Bangalore a little bit when we talk about infrastructure. Nobody thought Bangalore will become so big. I think in last one decade, if we take all the metros, Bangalore has grown the fastest. And when the old Bangalore was there, the majority facilities, government offices, hospitals, hotels, everything is at central location. Nothing is on outskirts. And now majority people lives on outskirts. Now if you really see everybody to come inside the city, and that creates the traffic choke. And that's the real problem for Bangalore.
But I thought Bangalore was growing all around.
No, I'm talking the facilities where people need to come for the social purpose, actually. Now, anybody to city, inside the city, road winding and other is a big issue. But now, outskirts, lot of infrastructure is getting developed. Like, see, if you take shopping mall, many five-star hotels have taken place outside. And schools, colleges have now many taken place on outskirts.
In fact, all your best schools, if you were living in the city center, it's a challenge. All your best schools are 22 kilometers away.
Absolutely.
But my granddaughter takes 1.5 hours to go to school and 2 hours to come back from school.
I know. Yeah, which is a
challenge. But that's quite a bit.
But now, if you really see, now the city is growing more outskirts. And more people, population is living on outskirts. I feel it's a matter of time. Definitely government need to organize the outskirts growth so that again the choke never take place.
Jovagis, are you confident of that? I mean, you're dealing with all the corporate clients. I'm sure you must be hearing that. Even though they, you know, for the manpower that Bangalore can offer, for just the cosmopolitan atmosphere it offers, all of that, it makes it the place to come and set up your office. But it's a challenge.
Yes, Mr. Razak actually spoke about the social fabric, and that's where Bangalore is, again, a unique position. So we hear the corporates. We actually speak to corporates, and they say they are considering this. What is the next choice? Should they be looking at expanding outside Bangalore?
Is Hyderabad and Chennai not a choice? Or in Gurgaon?
I was just coming to that. They actually don't want to move. They like Bangalore. The only problem is, what is the bottlenecks in the infra? How long will it take for the bottlenecks in the infrastructure to get resolved? One of the unique things you see in Bangalore is corporate India in Bangalore take a very active role in influencing the government.
Okay, so Bangalore versus Chennai versus Hyderabad, Jovagis, you still think that corporates are still making good given a choice, make a beeline for Bangalore first?
The only reason why they would look at the other markets would primarily to diversify and hedge their risks, right? Because that's one of the considerations, considering what happened in Chennai. You don't want to be in one location. But Bangalore is always taken as Bangalore, Pune also, I have to add Pune, is taken as an ideal choice because of the proximity to educational hubs and the social infrastructure. It's great for the type of people who come and work for IT companies, that age group, and that's what attracts people as well as companies to Bangalore.
All right, okay, I'm going to take a quick short break here. Bangalore versus Chennai versus Hyderabad, still a question that I need a quick reaction on from my other panelists, and of course get their top of the wish list, top three of 2016 when we come back.
The Realty Debate with Manisha Natarajan, powered by Reliance Home Finance.
Welcome back. Will Bangalore's real estate lead the recovery in 2015 is a question that we've been asking, debating, and of course the consensus seems to be yes, it's got the best chance to lead the recovery. On the question of Bangalore versus Hyderabad and Chennai and Pune, Gurgaon, these are pretty much the top five markets which come to your mind when you look at office space. What is the verdict? Mr. Sharma, what's the verdict? Why did Google go to Hyderabad?
It's a good question. Like Joe was telling, Hyderabad also has got a good infrastructure and great companies, right? And good affordability also. But if you look at from the Indian context, right, today, if India has to grow and grow at 8%, 9%, 10% on a consistent basis, then it has to have the services sector growing at a much faster pace. And from that perspective, we have only 5 or 6 centers of excellence. Hyderabad definitely is one among us them. But you have to look at from the customer's perspective today, who are going to decide the final decision as far as which city has to grow the maximum. And I think the verdict is clearly in favor of Bangalore, because every engineer today, right, after having worked in Hyderabad or in Pune or in Gurgaon or in Chennai or in Bangalore or in Mumbai, as such, he would like to live and settle down in Bangalore.
Mr. Razak?
I have a different take. Definitely Bangalore is the leader. In for whatever reasons my friend have expressed, so I don't want to repeat that again. But in an Indian context, I believe the other cities also have certain strengths. The cities that you've talked about, whether it's a Hyderabad or a Pune, and we go through this process whenever any multinational company wants to set up office. They also have a risk mitigation policy. They also don't like to put all the eggs in one basket. There's no question that if Google has gone to Hyderabad, that they won't have an office in Bangalore or a Pune. They are very clever. They want to be everywhere in all these 4 or 5 cities.
And so I think Chennai floods is a good reminder on why you need to diversify geographically.
So that is one great example. I wish it's actually bad. Otherwise, Chennai was growing on the IT front very rapidly. It's only sad that the floods really put it back on its back foot. And now it will take a lot of more convincing for the Chennai developers to say that, look, it was a one-off. It's not going to happen again. And Chennai was a different story. And it's a really resilient population, resilient city. They've all come back on their feet. It's all life is back to normal. There's no major change. Having said that, I believe all these 5, 6 cities will grow.
Ravinder, 2016, what is it that you would want as a citizen of this country? Let's go, like Mr. Razak has said, let's go beyond or above Bangalore for the country and for your business. What would be top on your priority list?
Yeah, so before I just have one comment on that, you know, the debate of Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai. I think these cities need to thank Bangalore and, you know, the indifference of Bangalore. They've just been beneficiaries of, you know, the indifference of Bangalore. You know, I think the state was ahead in terms of creating pockets of excellence like Electronic City, Whitefield, facilitating land acquisition for corporates that wanted to come and establish centers. I think sometimes we lost the way. So having said that, I think, you know, for me, high on the wish list is the real estate bill. I really hope that it sort of sees it,
gets tabled and passed and becomes law.
So speculation about whether it's good, bad, I think that will be set to rest. I think it will genuinely benefit good honest and big developers. So I think there will be consolidation in industry. So that is something that I'm looking for. Definitely looking for ease of approvals, you know, some sort of a single window or something that sort of crunches the time that is required to get approval from, I don't know, today maybe 12 to 24 months to maybe like a 6 month sort of a time frame. So some proactiveness over there.
Let me then get to Mr. Varghese and say, what is it that you would like?
I'll only put that in a different order. Mm-hmm. So I think across the country, there needs to be emphasis on infrastructure in the cities.
Yes.
That's the number one thing.
Priority every government.
For every government, every city. Bangalore has a unique combination of strengths that make it a little more attractive. But infrastructure could be the killer, right?
Yes.
For all the cities.
So it's not
right.
Something that you can just keep saying that, hey, irrespective of anything, Bangalore will continue to be high on the priority list of corporates. It could lose that plot.
That's right. So, that risk is there in pretty much every city here in India. The second thing is economic activity. Real estate is not the driver of the economy. It's actually a beneficiary of economic activity. So, from a perspective of investments coming in, new companies coming into India, GST bill, all these drive economic activity and make India as an attractive place for companies to locate their offices.
So 2016, that's on your wish list,
yes.
Mr. Sharma?
See, we hope that Real Estate Regulatory Act will become a law.
So that's one.
Right. So that means, again, that the responsible developers, where again I will bring the Bangalore into the picture kind of a thing, where the approvals are in place, where the sales happen, delivery happens, quality is good, transparency is excellent kind of a thing. Via process of transparency, I think we will see real estate getting into the hands of more and more organized players. I also hope that the sentiments change for the better, because prices are not going to go below where it exists today, whereas the interest rates will keep falling. So we do believe that the 2016 becomes the year of change that way, where the sentiments improve and somewhere the volumes also pick up, which will give a lot of comfort and confidence to the whole ecosystem.
Okay, Mr. Mantri, and then I will take the final word from Mr. Rathar.
I feel 2016 will be quite a transforming year.
You believe so?
Yeah, I believe so. Because if you see, the lessons learned are quite a lot. Even our present government, they made a importance of the Bangalore. They created a Bangalore Post. Now we are having a global investor meet next month. I think the whole approach and attitude is coming that something, somewhere the performance is very important. And I'm very sure the next 1 year we are going to see a lot of good things from government because they are in action.
Mr. Razak, you're that confident?
Yeah, I'm quite confident, number one. And of course, there are a lot of things to hope for. One is, one thing on top of the agenda for everybody, all developers across this country, though it's a localized subject, is the approval process, which again adds to cost. See, for me, there's a dream. Now, that dream is, our Prime Minister has said housing for all 2025 or whatever else. But then just saying it and not doing anything about it will just not change things. Now, just looking at 2016, I believe 2016, again, if we are positive, if these few things are fixed, like approval system, the real estate bill is almost a reality. GST, again, I believe I'm positive, will be a reality, if not in April, in September. Now, if these things happen, it will again change the way you do business.
All right. We'll conclude on that note. Mr. Sharma, Mr. Razak, Mr. Mantri, Mr. Pai, and Mr. Varghese, thank you very much for joining me on this discussion. Bangalore, it's always a pleasure to be in this city. There's so much more hope and optimism. And of course, like we said, in 2015, the leasing activity on office space gives us immense belief, or at least hope, that 2016 it could just continue, carry on, and Bangalore could be the first one to revive out of the doldrums, or I wouldn't say the doldrums here, but nationally the slowdown that real estate has faced. Thank you very much for joining me today.